Hey there, have you ever wondered how major tech giants like Google and Facebook manage to keep their mountains of codes in check? Or perhaps we're deciding how best to structure our own project's code. The way we manage our code can make or break the team's productivity and the product's stability. That's why today we're diving into the great debate, monorepos versus micro-repos. Before we dive in, did you know that the monorepo concept isn't new? Both Linux and Windows were created using a monorepo approach. Let's start with monorepos. Think of it as one central hub where all our code lives. Companies like Google, Facebook, and Uber, they've chosen their monorepo path. It's like a giant library, perhaps a bit daunting to navigate, but everything's under one roof. Just imagine, in Google's monorepo, there are billions of lines of code, all under one roof. Sounds pretty intense, right? Now let's go through the pros and cons of monorepos. Here's one clear benefit of monorepo. Making cross-project changes becomes a breeze. Let's say we have a utility function that's used in 10 different services, and we need to make a change. In a monorepo, we can do this in one commit, in one place. Then there's dependency management. Instead of wrestling with multiple versions of a package across different repositories, we've got a single consolidated view of our dependencies. Consistency is another big win for monorepos. You know how code reviews sometimes feel like the Wild West with different rules and standards across teams? Well, with a monorepo, everyone's playing by the same rules. And don't forget code reuse. Need a functionality that's already been developed for another service? No need to recreate the wheel. We can see everything in the monorepo, making it straightforward to repurpose code. However, it's not without challenges. Monorepos require careful planning and the right tools. Google even had to build a dedicated tool called Blaze and staff a large team to support their massive code base. Facebook uses Buck for similar reasons. And as the repo grows, without careful management, the CI/CD pipelines might start moving at a snail's pace. This is another area that requires a heavy level of staffing. And for the new developers, a large repo can be overwhelming. But with a well-documented code base and structured onboarding process, even the largest code base can become manageable. Lastly, although each team's own a section of monorepo, customization can be tricky. Teams can't always independently use different tools or libraries due to possible conflicts, and major changes need to consider the entire code base. That said, using tools like Google's Bazel and maintaining good communication can help balance this trade-off, allowing teams to flexibly evolve with shared guidelines. Now let's switch gears to micro-repos. This approach treats each component or service as an independent entity with its own separate repository. Organizations such as Amazon and Netflix have embraced this decentralized method. Now let's walk through the pros and cons. Micro-repos offer independence. Each team can manage and scale the repos as needed. Another advantage is risk isolation. If something goes wrong in one repo, it doesn't affect the others, reducing their blast radius. This approach also provides flexibility. Each team can select the best tools for their repo and tailor the environment to their exact needs. And there's a clear sense of ownership. Each team manages their own repo. However, there are downsides. Coordinating changes across multiple repos can be challenging. It requires solid collaboration and possibly specialized tooling. Managing dependencies across many repos can be challenging, but tools like Nexus or Artifactory can help. Without a unified standard, code standards can vary widely. This can lead to poor code quality or inconsistent patterns. To prevent this, it's important to establish organization-wide coding guidelines. And one more thing, code duplication. Copying the same code across repos bloats the code base and can lead to bugs. To avoid this, creating shared libraries for common code can be useful. Now, so the big question, monorepo or microrepos? Well, as with many things in tech, it's not black and white. The best approach depends on factors like the team's need, the size of the organization, the nature of the projects, and the company's culture. Monorepos bring consistency, make cross-project changes smoother, and promote co-reuse. They are a great fit if we have large teams working on interconnected projects, where collaboration and consistency is a key. But remember, they require careful upfront planning and tooling. Unmanaged, they can affect the performance of the CI/CD pipelines and offer less flexibility to individual teams. On the flip side, microrepos offer flexibility, risk isolation, and clear ownership. They can be a good choice for organizations that prioritize team autonomy, especially if teams are working on distinct projects. But they come with their own challenges. They can be more complex to manage, especially when making cross-repo changes, and may lead to code duplication if not managed well. So, what worked best for you? Share your chosen strategy in the comments and let us know why you opted for it. Looking forward to hearing from your experiences with monorepos and microrepos. If you like our videos, you might like our system design newsletter as well. It covers topics and trends in large-scale system design, trusted by 450,000 readers. Subscribe at blog.bybygo.com.